Okay, so we are looking at asphyxia neonatorum. So we are going to look at asphyxia neonatorum, and we can define asphyxia neonatorum as this is a neonatal condition. So this is a neonatal condition in which there is failure of the baby to initiate or sustain breathing at birth, characterized by bluish discoloration of the body, lack of stimuli or lack of muscle tone, and apart from that, poor or no respirations. So in asphyxia neonatorum, mainly you are going to see characteristics such as bluish discoloration of the body, indicating to say there is reduced oxygen supply to the body tissues. Then apart from that, there will be lack of respiration. So you check the rising and falling of the chest. There's nothing, meaning the baby is not breathing. Apart from that, there could also be poor muscle tone due to also lack of oxygen supply and also nutrient supply to the muscles. As a result, the baby is just going to look flat. So from there, we can move on to assessment of asphyxia. When it comes to assessing asphyxia neonatorum, you use APGAR score, which is just a means of assessing the presence or absence of anoxia in a newborn infant. So APGAR score is used to assess the presence or absence of anoxia, meaning lack of oxygen. And this assessment is based on five factors that we'll talk about, which is the pulse in terms of the heart rate, respiratory rate, the muscle tone, the grimace, and also appearance. So those are the factors that you're going to look at, and these will look at them in the next slide. Then you use the APGAR score to assess the level of asphyxia at 1 minute and also at 5 minutes, meaning as soon as the baby is born, you assess the APGAR score, and then you also recheck it at 5 minutes. The APGAR score is an objective method of evaluating the newborn condition, and it can also be used to evaluate the effectiveness of resuscitation effort or measures. So when it comes to the APGAR score, these are the things that you need to check. So the first thing that you need to check is the pulse. So you need to check the pulse, and the pulse, you're checking it in terms of the heart rate. And if the heart rate is absent, meaning you're going to give a score of 0. If you check the heart rate, it is below 100, you're going to give a score of 1. But if you check the heart rate of above 100, you'll give a score of 2, which is a perfect score in this case. Then when it comes to respiratory rate, again, when the respirations are absent, you're going to give a score of 0. If the respirations are irregular or weak, or if there's if there's weak cry, meaning you're going to give a score of 1. If the baby cries immediately after being delivered, you'll give a score of 2. Then when it comes to the muscle tone, so in terms of the muscle tone, if the baby is limp, you're going to give a score of 0. But if there is some flexion of extremities, if the baby is able to raise some legs or some hands, meaning you give a score of 1. But if there is active motion, if this baby is active, you'll give a perfect score, which is 2. Then when it comes to grimace, so in terms of grimace, and this is in terms of response to stimuli or irritation. So if you touch the baby, you feel there's no response, you are going to give a score of 0. If there's some motion, you'll give a score of 1. And if the baby cries, you're going to give a score of 2. And the last thing, when it comes to appearance, and you are looking at in terms of color, if the baby looks bluish or pale, you'll give a score of 0. And if the baby has the body which is pink, but extremities which are blue, you give a score of 1. But if the baby is completely pink, you're going to give a score of 2. So pink is a good sign, meaning this baby has oxygen being delivered to all body tissue. So that is the APGAR score, and that's how you can grade on the APGAR score. So we can move on to the classification of asphyxia. So when it comes to classifying asphyxia, we'll start with the normal. So a score between 8 to 10, this is classified as a child being normal. So meaning this child is just okay. There are no interventions that you need to do. So if the baby gets a score at normal, if a baby gets a score of 8 to 10 at 1 minute, that is normal. And in this, what can qualify a baby getting this score is that you see the body will be pink, but the extremities may be blue, and the breaths there will be good breaths, and also the baby will be able to cry. Apart from that, the muscle tone will be okay, and the heart rate or the heartbeat is going to be greater than 100 beats per minute. Apart from that, the child will also be active, or it will respond to stimuli. So that is normal. But then when it comes to mild asphyxia, so mild asphyxia has a score between 5 to 7. And in terms of characteristics here, the heart rate is severely depressed. It may even range between 60 to 8 beats per minute. Apart from that, there is a short delay in onset of respiration. The muscle tone may be good. And also the baby may respond to stimuli, but the baby may be deeply cyanosed. So those are the characteristics under mild asphyxia. Apart from that, here there is no significant deprivation of oxygen during labor. Then the last classification is severe asphyxia. So in terms of severe asphyxia here, the APGAR score is less than 5. So any APGAR score less than 5 at 1 minute, meaning this child has severe asphyxia. Here there is a slow feeble heart rate, which may be even less than 40 beats per minute. There is no attempt to breathe. You check that there is poor muscle tone. The baby is limp and also unresponsive to stimuli. The baby looks grayish, and this is due to vasoconstriction. And apart from that, there is also lack of oxygen due to which may be prolonged before or after delivery. There is also circulatory failure, which is present, and the baby may even be in shock. So these are the characteristics that you're going to see under severe asphyxia. So those are the three classifications of asphyxia. From here, we can move on and look at the causes of asphyxia neonatorum. So when it comes to the causes of asphyxia neonatorum, we'll group them in terms of fetal causes, maternal causes, placenta causes, umbilical causes, and also drug causes. So we'll start with fetal causes. So when it comes to fetal causes of asphyxia neonatorum, here the first one is that they could be blocked air passages by LIQA or meconium. So the first one, it could be that the air could be blocked by the LIQA, which is the amniotic fluid, or the meconium itself. Apart from that, it could be due to birth trauma, especially where the head is coming in, where the baby is being delivered in breech position. So it can result in birth trauma causing or impairing oxygen supply. Then apart from that, prematurity is another fetal cause. Remember, in prematurity, the lungs are not mature enough for them to be able to give out enough oxygen. Sometimes in prematurity, it could be lack of pulmonary surfactant, which is required to maintain surface tension of the lungs so that respirations are maintained. Apart from that, it could be intrauterine growth retardation, which may be a fetal cause of neonatal asphyxia. Then when it comes to maternal causes, so in terms of maternal causes, this is mainly related to deficiency in oxygen supply to the mother. For example, where the mother has severe anemia, hypertension, cardiac disease, or pulmonary tuberculosis. These conditions will result in reduced oxygen supply to the mother, meaning even the baby will receive less oxygen, and then this may result in neonatal asphyxia. Apart from that, eclampsia, preeclampsia, also diabetes, this condition may predispose the child to neonatal asphyxia. So hypertension in pregnancy, these things may cause neonatal asphyxia. Then also prolonged labor. So prolonged labor is another maternal cause, obstructed labor, all these things. And also if the mother goes into shock, this is another maternal cause of neonatal asphyxia. So if the mother goes into shock, this may impair oxygen supply to the newborn. Then when it comes to placenta causes, we can look at it maybe in terms of antepartum hemorrhage. So antepartum hemorrhage, it could be maybe due to early detachment of the uterus, causing this woman to bleed or excessively bleed, meaning oxygen supply will be impaired to the baby. Placenta previa, placenta abruptio, these are some of the abnormalities that may occur, which may even impair oxygen supply to the baby. Infarction, where there is death of body tissue, it could be infarction on the umbilical cord or the maternal part, impairing supply of oxygen to the newborn. So these are placental causes. Then there are also diseases like syphilis and also hemolytic diseases of a newborn. So these conditions may impair oxygen supply to the newborn. If you look at an example of syphilis, you'll find that as you are even doing examination of a placenta, it will look grayish to someone who suffered from syphilis. It indicates to say there was death of tissue on the maternal part of the placenta, meaning oxygen supply was impaired at some point. Then apart from that, we have umbilical causes. So in terms of umbilical causes, it could be cord presentation. So sometimes the cord can be presented or can be inserted on the edge of the placenta, meaning there will be no enough oxygen supply to the baby. You have placenta abnormalities such as the battle door. You have and succuriata. So those are umbilical abnormalities, meaning the umbilical cord is not nicely embedded in the placenta. Apart from that, cord prolapse is another umbilical cause. Compression of the cord for any reason, especially in cord prolapse and also malpresentation, are other causes. So you may find that as the baby is being born, there is a cord wrapping around the neck, which may be compressed during delivery, impairing oxygen supply to the baby and causing the baby to go into asphyxia. Then true knots also to the cord are also a cause of neonatal asphyxia. Then when it comes to drug causes, in terms of drug causes, it could be the mother taking drugs such as Valium and taking it shortly before delivery. This may impair oxygen supply to the newborn. Anesthetic drugs also depress the respiratory centers of the fetus. And apart from that, also misuse of oxytocin drugs in labor may cause asphyxia neonatorum. Remember, oxytocin initiates contractions, so these contractions may even end up impairing oxygen supply to the newborn. So these are some of the causes of neonatal asphyxia, and they have been group mentioned in terms of groups. So when it comes to managing asphyxia neonatorum, so when it comes to managing asphyxia neonatorum, this is an emergency condition. Therefore, you are going to have aims such as to establish and maintain a clear airway, ventilation and oxygenation. Apart from that, to ensure effective circulation, to correct acidosis, to prevent infection. So when it comes to your first heading, this is going to be a patient resuscitation. So the cardinal management when managing neonatal asphyxia will be nursing management, and then you just mention medication under the nursing management, that such as adrenaline can be given and other things. But when managing neonatal asphyxia, consider first the nursing management. So in terms of neonatal asphyxia, I've said you start with your first heading, which is the patient resuscitation, and here you check the airway, breathing and the circulation. On the airway, as usual, you need to ensure that the airway is patent. You can suction, you remove aspirated meconium, any like aspirated, you need to suction all those things. Apart from that, you can even reposition the baby for free flow of secretions. In terms of breathing, here you can give oxygen 1 to 2 liters per minute. So do not give overdose of oxygen. In children, you give 1 to 2 liters per minute, because if you give overdose, it may lead to a complication called retrorenal fibroplasia. Apart from that, it may also lead to damage to the retina. So you need to ensure that you give correct doses in children, which is 1 to 2 liters per minute. So apart from giving oxygen, so that's the major thing you can give in neonates. You don't have to expose the baby to well-ventilated environments, because you need to prevent hypothermia, because hypothermia worsens the condition. So in terms of circulation, you can give normal saline as a blood expander. You can give dextrose for energy, so that the baby is able to use accessory muscles. Then from there, you can talk about prevention of hypothermia. So in terms of prevention of hypothermia, you need to keep the baby warm. Apart from keeping the baby warm, you need to nurse the baby in a warm environment, provide more linen, and everything about keeping the baby warm. Then apart from that, also talk about prevention of hypoglycemia. So in terms of hypoglycemia, you need to initiate feeding immediately. So breastfeed, ensure that the child is breastfed immediately. If there's no suckling reflex, you can give expressed breast milk, and by inserting a nasogastric tube, and you'll give it through an NG tube. Apart from that, you can also give 10% dextrose for energy. Then prevention of infection is another heading that you need to put in your immediate care. You need to prevent infections at all costs, meaning you need to maintain aseptic techniques and also ensure that the environment for the child is clean and dust-free or infection-free. And you also need to use instruments to this child, specifically for this child, without sharing with other patients, to avoid transmission of infection from one patient to the other. And apart from that, you can talk about other points which can help in prevention of infection. From there, now you can even talk about observations. As usual, do the temperature, pulse, respirations for baseline information. You can also observe the rising and falling of the chest, which may indicate resuscitation of the child. You can check the bluish discoloration if it's disappearing, and if the baby is turning pink, meaning the baby is being resuscitated, and many other points that you can use on observation. From there, talk about hygiene. In terms of hygiene, you can do top and tail. Apart from top and tail, you can do eye care. And also, apart from that, you can ensure that you clean the cot bed or the recess there. Ensure that the baby is nest in a clean environment. So you can do cot bed care, change of linen whenever sold, and many other points that you can use on hygiene. But ensure that you talk about top and tail. Apart from that, you can also talk about headings such as nutrition, which is important, and it can promote healing or recovery. So in terms of nutrition, as usual, you need to breastfeed the child as soon as possible. If the child is unable to be breastfed, you can give expressed breast milk using an NG tube or expressed in a cup. Apart from that, you can give dextrose for energy. So it will be more of a repetition of points from circulation. So if you want, you can even skip the heading for nutrition. This is a newborn. You don't have to give small frequent meals. This child only requires breast milk. Then in terms of medication, you will say, I will ensure that the child is given resuscitative medication such as adrenaline. Apart from adrenaline, other drugs that can be given is sodium bicarbonate. So sodium bicarbonate can be given also in this condition. So you just ensure that I will ensure the baby is given the prescribed medication such as adrenaline, sodium bicarbonate to correct respiratory acidosis, also calcium gluconate, which is 1 mL/kg body weight, to correct hypocalcemia. Dexamethasone can also be given in cases of cerebral edema. So we just have to ensure these drugs are given, and I'll explain the side effects to the mother, the mode of action, and the reason why we are giving these drugs. So those points need to come out on medication. From there, talk about elimination. So in terms of elimination, you check the output and compare it to the input by using a fluid balance chart, and this will be done to rule out fluid overload by checking the feces, the baby's past meconium, and also the urine output. So that is how your management should come out. Then from there, when it comes to prevention of asphyxia neonatorum, so in terms of prevention of asphyxia neonatorum, you can talk about in antenatally, where there's early detection and treatment of illnesses like pulmonary tuberculosis, anemia, hypertension, diabetes. So these conditions can be prevented during antenatal. Good nutrition to prevent anemia, so, and also malnutrition. Also good antenatal care, which includes head to toe examination, which may be used or helpful in detection of any abnormality. IEC to the mother on effects of traditional oxytocin. So many women would prefer use of oxytocin medication so that they deliver fast, but this may predispose a child to asphyxia. And apart from that, during labor, you may also avoid misuse of oxytocin drugs, because oxytocin drugs may even cause asphyxia if they are misused. Apart from that, also avoid prolonged second stage of labor. So therefore, you need to give proper management of first stage of labor by use of hepatograph to rule out deviations from normal. Also, just being vigilant to ensure that the cord is not tied around the neck, meaning as soon as the head comes out, you need to go in with two fingers and check if at all the there's a cord around the neck. So those are some of the preventive measures that can be used in prevention of asphyxia. So we'll end today with asphyxia neonatorum, and we'll continue with other conditions next time. Thank you so much for taking time to go through this lesson for today. We'll see you, we'll meet next time as we look at other conditions.